A while ago, Mrs. White once was preaching at the Healdsburg College. And I think this was mentioned, maybe by you, I'm not sure. But this was before PUC, Pacific Union College, became a college yet. And so Mrs. White looked over the audience and she noticed that everybody was sitting in the back of the auditorium. And so she asked, "Brethren, why did you come here today?" In other words, why did you come to church? She said a lot of other things. And so the people got up and walked up to the front. And I think, I'm not sure who it was the pastor or whatever, but he mentioned that she talked about it's the evil angels that take the front seats and try to keep you from hearing the message. Well, I'd like to ask the same kind of question. What do we believe and why do we believe it? You know, we're talking about the final atonement. And, we're living in the antitypical day of atonement in heaven. Well, do we believe that this is true, or do we believe that the atonement was really completed at the cross? Now, I know we're, as they say, I'm speaking to the choir because we're all here in the morning. But, the whole world basically, pretty much the whole world believes that the atonement was completed at the cross. And on top of that, the Adventist church, the structure, has also changed their understanding of our atonement so that Jesus is somehow working with the atonement that he had already completed at the cross. I can't remember the words, how they say it, but it's almost the same thing. So if we believe in the antitypical day of atonement, we're a rare breed. Well, how did we get this way, and how did we ever come up with such a distinctive doctrine as the final atonement? Many people believe that this is what separates the Adventists from all the other Christians. In Loma Linda, there are discussions about, why do we need to be a church? I mean, we don't believe this anymore. We don't believe in... Is there anything that we believe that nobody else believed, as if that was the reason? And they were doing very well at doing away with many of our doctrines. This morning I'd like to cover a little bit about how we came to our understanding of the final atonement. I want to for us to realize that we can find pretty much most of the answers about the final atonement from the Bible. We have Mrs. White, and we need to use her because she directs us to the knowledge that we have in the scriptures. But what does the Bible actually say? And also, how did we come up with our doctrines? Let's go to slide 2. In Four Testimonies, 595, paragraph 4 and the first part of 5, she says, "It is as certain that we have the truth as that God lives."
Amen.
Now that's strong assurance, isn't it?
Yes.
Now we know that Mrs. White had a strong association with God, and her experience was something that we need to go approach Christ and God, but she had a high level of confidence and closeness with God.
Amen.
But Adventists, as a rule, knew this to be true as well, that it was certain that we had the truth. Continuing, "And Satan, with all his arts and hellish power, cannot change the truth of God into a lie."
Amen.
The truth of God. that she calls this. While the great adversary will try his utmost to make of none effect the word of God, truth must go forth as a lamp that burneth. And I especially like this next part. I've just taken the first sentence. The Lord has singled us out and made us subjects of his marvelous mercy. You know, I don't want to call it strange, but that is a marvelous statement. Can you imagine that we as Adventists have been singled out in the whole world to have this knowledge that we have? You know, nobody has a truth like Seventh-day Adventists, at least historically. And historically, people were afraid to argue with Adventists because they knew the Bible. Now, I have my own experience. I must have been near Ashley's age, and our family was taking a vacation in the summertime, and we went out to eastern Maryland, and we were camping in one of these great campsites, with camping, as some of you might be doing. And we got our tent up and everything, and us kids started walking around, and right next door there's this man, and he had his sight was just picture perfect, and it looked like he had been there for a while. He was just kind of camping out for the summer, at least a couple weeks or something. And so by and by we started to talk to him. It turned out he was a pastor of some church. I'm not sure what it was. And he asked, well, what are you? Well, we're Seventh-day Adventists. And right away, I'll never forget this. Everything changed. Oh, Seventh-day Adventists. And he mentioned, oh, you know, I'd like to study with you, you know. And I didn't want to study. I didn't really know what we believed. I couldn't open up in the Bible and say, well, you're not correct on this, or, you know, or anything of that sort. I stayed away, as I'm sure everybody else did. But I'll never forget the attitude he had toward us. And I have realized, you know, Adventists today really don't have a real good understanding of the Bible anymore. We're not as we used to be.
Amen.
But yet, you know, why would God give us this message that gave the early Adventists such a strong assurance that we had the truth? What was it? They obviously studied. They spent time with God. That's what we need to be doing. And we're going to be going through that very time that they thought they might be going through. Let's go to our third. Even in early writings, I've got picked up a view that Mrs. White was talking about how we came up with our doctrines. And this is early writings, page 258, paragraph 3. I was again brought down through these messages and saw how dearly the people of God had purchased their experience. Well, how did they purchase their experience? How was it? It had been obtained through much suffering and severe conflict. God had led them along step by step. So this sounds like it's a process. It's not just a single step. Until he had placed them upon a solid, immovable platform. When she starts talking about a platform, what's she talking about? The foundation of truth. These are the prophecies. These are the doctrines that we know that will never change.
Amen.
Cool. So this was obviously a process, and this solid, immovable platform is the pillars of our faith. And this next slide four, this is one of many times, this is 60 years after it happened, 50 or 60 years, and this is Review and Herald, June 14, 1906, and we're looking at paragraph 18. In the early days of the message, when our members were few, we studied diligently to understand the meaning of many scriptures. And I'm guessing that this was like the 1850s. Am I about right there? 1850s? Maybe? Yeah. Okay. So this is very early time, and she said the numbers of our company were few. At times it seemed as if no explanation could be given. So they struggled with these verses, trying to understand these basic doctrines. And the next part, my mind seemed to be locked to an understanding of the word. So Mrs. White couldn't understand what they were talking about. She couldn't get it in there and understand and take part in the process. So she talks about this in many of the other places. But, continuing, when our brethren who had assembled for study came to a point where they could go no farther and had recourse to earnest prayer, so they realized that they could not find the answers themselves and they asked for help. And that is when, continuing, the Spirit of God would rest upon me and I would be taken off into vision and be instructed in regard to relation of Scripture to Scripture. Amen. Yeah, amen. This is how I think many of our doctrines were given to us. Continuing, these experiences were repeated over and over and over again. And this is why I chose this quote rather than some of the others. I don't think she emphasizes this as much, that this was a process. It didn't happen just once or twice or whatever, but it happened over and over and over again. Thus, many truths of the third angel's message were established point by point. Praise God, exactly. You know, there is a precedence in this, and I didn't bring my Bible with me, but if you know the road to Emmaus, Luke 24, there is experience of a couple of the disciples who were walking to Emmaus, and they were downcast. And they were talking amongst themselves what had happened. And Jesus came amongst them, but of course they didn't recognize him because they weren't supposed to. And Jesus asked them, "Why are you so sad?" And, "Oh, haven't you heard?" And they told what had just happened or whatever. And then finding out that his body wasn't in the grave, and what does all this mean? And finally Jesus said, "Oh, you're slow of learning." And then he started to expound the scriptures. He explained the scriptures to them. And I realized that this is the same experience that the early Adventists had. Amen. We had the Bible. We couldn't make any sense out of it. And it took God's intervention to help us nail down many of these proofs. Because not everybody understood the same thing. They were divided many times. And often they had to go home and pray for the right spirit. Let's go to five. Yes, first selected messages. Thank you. As a people, we are to stand firm on the platform of eternal truth that has withstood test and trial. We are to hold to the sure pillars of our faith, the principles of truth that God has revealed to us, are our only true foundation. Here she spells it out. God has revealed to us. Continuing, they have made us what we are. The lapse of time has not lessened their value. It is the constant effort of the enemy to remove these truths from their setting and to put in their place spurious theories. He will bring in everything he possibly can to carry out his deceptive designs. And of course, you know, we can see this. This has already happened, hasn't it? It seems like the church has walked away from so many of the doctrines that should never change.
Amen.
Continuing, but the Lord will raise up men of keen perception who will give these truths their proper place in the plan of God. And I believe that's happening with us here and now, and it's going to be accelerated. There's going to be more of this in the future.
Praise the Lord.
God's people, some of God's people, are going to be discovering what we as a church have always believed. The next, slide 6. In my own study, I've used the sources at the bottom, Counsels to Writers and Editors, First Testimonies, You Shall Receive Power, Review and Herald, and Great Controversy. I've came up with 8 different things, and they overlap some, but I've used the phrases that she uses in these sources. And number 4 here is, of course, the one that we're interested in. This is the final atonement, the 2-compartment heavenly sanctuary, which includes the temple of God, the ark containing the law of God, Christ's priesthood, the cleansing of the sanctuary transpiring in heaven, and having decided relation to God's people on the earth. So that's what we're looking at this camp meeting. This is one of our doctrines that should never change. Not only have we been told what this doctrine is, but when they looked at the scriptures, they were actually able to see that, yes, that's what the Bible taught. And they couldn't see it before. Let's go to the slide 7. A while ago, I was reading a source where, for Mrs. White, where she was taken off into vision, and she was instructed in regard to scripture to scripture, and then these experiences were repeated over and over and over again. Well, that wasn't the end of the paragraph. It continues. She said that for this part of the paragraph. Think you that my faith in this message will ever waver? In other words, this is the experience that we've just experienced. And we've gone through this. And do you think that my faith in this message will ever waver? When you look at what she has just talked about, and then she says this, it's a strong statement. It's a strong experience that they went through. Think you that I can remain silent when I see an effort being made to sweep away the foundation pillars of our faith? I am as thoroughly established in these truths as it is possible for a person to be. I can never forget the experience I have passed through. God has confirmed my belief in many evidences of His power.
Amen.
Yeah. Next paragraph. Number 8.
It will be like that for us too.
It's what?
It will be like that for us.
Yes.
We will have those experiences.
We must be faithful. Amen. Right? There's so many things that we need to be looking at. This is a manuscript release in volume 10, and it's page 45.2. She says, the truths that we have been proclaiming for more than half a century have been contested again and again. Again and again, the facts of faith have been disputed, but every time, the Lord has established the truth by the working of His Holy Spirit. Those who have arisen to question and overthrow the principles of present truth, she calls this present truth, right? That's what we have been sternly rebuked. And I wanted to include this for that last little phrase. These people who've tried to change our doctrines, they have been strongly rebuked when Mrs. White was alive. Our history would not have been the same without a prophet, would they? Amen. Well, what happened after she died? And next, number 9. This is manuscript 1, 1915, and this actually wasn't written by Mrs. White, but she was in her bed, and she would say things when she would wake up, or if she went into vision or whatever, and these things were written out in two letters. One is the 24th February 1915, and then there's another one. It's further on. And I'm just going to read, maybe starting with the first red section. This is a quote that we all know. When I am laid to rest, great changes will take place. And they actually waited for her to die because they couldn't do anything. I do not know when I shall be taken, but I desire to warn all against the devices of the devil. I want the people to know that I warned them fully before my death. I do not know especially what changes will take place, but Satan's devices will be brought before the people. So she told us things are going to be changing, and they have, haven't they? This isn't the same church, at least the organization. Now, next, number 10. Satan has laid his plans to undermine our faith in the history of the cause and work of God. I am deeply in earnest as I write this. And this shows, you know, the urgency of this statement. I am deeply in earnest as I write this. Satan is working with men of prominent position. So we're looking at maybe the leaders of the church to sweep away the foundations of our faith. This is Review and Herald, November 12, 1903. And this is paragraph 13. So this is a change has happened in the church, and it started from the top down, from the leadership. The next paragraph. This is First Selected Messages, 207, paragraph 3. What influence is it that, I'm including a word here, would lead men at this stage of our history to work in an underhand, powerful way to tear down the foundation of our faith? So they're going to be sneaky, or they have been sneaky about this. So they're going to be sneaky about this, in fact, to such an extent that, let's go to, were we on 11? Okay, let's go to 12. I'm going to start with the intense blue here. They will bring in all conceivable fallacies and will present them as coming from Mrs. White, that they may beguile souls. So this is how sneaky they're going to be. Mrs. White never changed her viewpoint on any of these, but they would look at this statement and that statement and change her meaning. So this is a serious situation. Obviously, there is a war over truth, isn't there? The truth that we have received, you know, must be so important. And this is why Satan has especially attacked it. If he thinks that if it's that important, that means it's even more important for us to study these things. This must be something that we need to, in order to survive this time ahead, in order to be saved. There has to be a reason why God gave us these doctrines. And especially the final atonement. There's something about this, about our needing to come to the throne of grace. To ask for forgiveness and for needed power and all the things that we understand these things and that we're learning. If we didn't have that, what would we be doing? We'd be like the other churches. Next, number 13. Now, I have two quotes here where I just talk about, or I have quotes which refer to the essential necessity that we need to study these things. This is Review and Herald, December 18, 1888, paragraph 12. It does not seem possible for us now that any should have to stand alone. But we're going to have to stand alone. Continuing. But if God has ever spoken by me, the time will come when we shall be brought before councils and before thousands for his name's sake. And each one will have, each one that's individually, will have to stand. And each one, continuing, will have to give the reason of his faith. Then will come the severest criticism upon every position that has been taken for the truth. So there's going to be a lot of pressure.
Amen.
We need then to study the Word of God that we may know why we believe the doctrines we advocate. And if we don't know, it's going to be a bad situation. Next. This is Our High Calling, 356, paragraph 2. The servants of Christ are to prepare no set speech to present when brought to trial for our faith. So we know they're going to be highly pressured. It's going to be nasty. We're going to have to stand alone. But yet we're not to prepare? Is that what she's saying? No. Their preparation, I'm continuing, their preparation is to be made day by day in treasuring up in their hearts the precious truths of God's Word, in feeding upon the teaching of Christ, and through prayer strengthening their faith. So how much time are we really spending at the throne of grace? That's what we're studying about, isn't it? Are we actually following that? We know the warning. Are we following the warning? Continuing. Then, when brought into trial, the Holy Spirit will bring to their remembrance the very truths that will reach the hearts of those who shall come to hear. God will flash the knowledge obtained by diligent searching of the Scriptures into their memory at the very time when it is needed.
Amen.
Praise God, that's right. Because, you know, I have Lyme disease and I can't, you know, I was trying, what's Ashley's, I couldn't remember what your name was. And I thought about it and wrote it down so I wouldn't forget. Because I wanted to show how young I was, you know, when we were out camping. My memory is bad. I'm not even old yet. I'm only 62. That's old, isn't it? Well, anyway, each one of us at some level in life, we have various problems. When this time comes, we could be nervous or whatever, but God is going to bless us.
Amen.
He's going to, with those things that we have studied, He will bring these things to mind. I mean, praise God.
Amen.
We need to study these things, not only from Mrs. White, but we need to look at the Bible. Not because Mrs. White isn't inspired, but because the world believes in the Bible. And this was mentioned before. Let's go to number 15. And so what I want to do is to look at some various texts. Actually, it's from my website. But I wanted to look at some things from the biblical perspective alone, except it's not really, because, you know, even if I don't mention Mrs. White, you know, her ideas have shaped my understanding of scriptures, haven't they? And it's because of that these all make sense. Let's read this. This is Exodus 33:19. This is when Moses was up on the mountain and he asked, could I see more of your glory? And he wanted, Mrs. White says that he wanted to become closer and he wanted to have a fuller experience with God. And he said, I'm reading, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. So it looks like he's going to have great mercy, but it isn't going to be on all people. Is that right? Is that what that's saying? This is Exodus 33. It's gone to the next, number 16. So this is when God actually does it, and this is probably Jesus. Exodus 34, verses 6 and 7. And the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. But these are marvelous, wonderful statements. But look at the rest of it. And that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children unto the third and to the fourth generation. That first part, and that will by no means clear the guilty. I mean, we've all been guilty. How can God work with some but yet not with others? When we've all been guilty, what's the difference?
The amount of participation we have with him.
Yes. Basically, I think the difference is the atonement process.
Amen.
You know, there are two phases of the atonement. We've been looking at this, and I'm just going to look at Leviticus 4, verses 29 to 31. That's slide 17. And he shall lay his hand upon the head of the sin offering, and slay the sin offering in the place of the burnt offering. And then verse 30 and much of 31, the priest is going to be doing various things. The priest shall take the blood thereof with his finger and put it upon the horns of the altar of the burnt offering, and shall pour out all the blood thereof at the bottom of the altar. And he shall take away all the fat thereof, as the fat is taken away from off the sacrifice of peace offerings. And the priest shall burn it upon the altar for a sweet savor unto the Lord. And the priest, and obviously this is the important part, at least it's what I deemed it to be, it's all important. The priest shall make an atonement for him, and it shall be forgiven him. So this is the first phase, and it was done daily. And we've talked a lot about this this week already. This is the first phase of the atonement, the daily. And we notice that we're forgiven. Okay, let's go to the next slide. This is the second phase. And all these have already been quoted so many times, and we know these verses. Leviticus 16, verse 30. For on that day shall, and this is the Day of Atonement, shall the priest make an atonement for you to cleanse you, that ye may be clean from all your sins. So the first one, what does God do for us?
Forgiveness.
For I didn't hear. Forgiveness, okay. And now the second, it's a cleansing. So we don't, today, we're not doing these kinds of services on earth. Of course, we have an even better high priest, the Son of God. What does Jesus do for us? Let's go to slide 18, or 19. This is a text we all know, 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, and where is this done? Is this talking about the final atonement? Who are we approaching? We're approaching, we talk to God through Jesus, don't we? So this is at the throne of grace. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just, what?
To forgive us
our sins and
cleanse.
To cleanse us. So we pick up the same benefits that they did way back then, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So, next slide. Oh, let's go back that one. I just wanted to ask a question. Oh, looking at the time. It's speeding on. When are these things, when are these gifts given to us? When are we forgiven?
Forgiven at the cross.
At the point of confession.
At the point of confession.
It's applied to us. The actual forgiveness was purchased as Christ was the Lamb slain before the
foundation right.
of the world. It's almost like He wrote out a check for forgiveness and it was cashed in the bank of heaven in Calvary, mm-hmm. but then we get the proceeds from it when we come to receive it.
You know, it's a process, isn't it?
Yes.
And the slaying of the Lamb or the Lamb of God is the first step.
Amen.
The first step.
Acknowledging Him as our sacrifice.
That's right. How about when are we cleansed from our sin?
Cleansed.
When?
The final atonement, we're completely cleansed.
As our heart is circumcised from that sin.
Okay. What does it mean to be cleansed? Is this when everything's scrubbed out, or what does it mean?
I believe it means to have the mind of Christ.
Okay.
The sin begins in the mind, and unless my mind is changed,
well, my thinking was, and I could be wrong with this, you know, we're forgiven, but has the sin been forgotten by God? Has it been? It's not.
No.
When is it forgotten by God? Is that what is meant by the cleansing?
It could be.
That's the cleansing.
So what?
I've always seen it as sanctification, but you could also consider that.
Okay. Yeah, we'll all have to study more. This is deep, isn't it?
The complete removal comes at that.
And in the Bible, we don't have everything fully explained like Mrs. White. You know, you have to look very closely. But there are several quotes. If you're writing down some scriptures, I have Matthew 18. Verses 23 to 35, this is a parable that Jesus gave. And somebody owed some money to their master, and he pled for mercy, and he gave it. But then the same person went to his buddy and demanded, you know, a pittance, a small amount, and he put him in jail because he couldn't do anything. And when his master found out, he unforgave him. And then Jesus says, God would do the same thing for you. And so there must be a point at which we know that things won't change. And we know that that's when Jesus or Michael stands up.
Right. Okay.
And that's Revelation 22:11. We also have Daniel 12. I forget the verse, the first, second, or third, or some is right at the beginning. Acts 3, verses 19 to 21 is also good if you want to write that down. These are all very good verses. Okay, let's go to the next slide 20. This is 1 John 2, verses 1 and 2. My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ourselves only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And I looked up in my computer, I guess that's the easiest way. What does propitiation mean? An appeasing, I don't like that. Or an expiator. It's the act of atoning for sin. The one who atones for our sin. And obviously Jesus is that person. And next. This is Hebrews 4, verses 15 and 16. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin.
Amen.
Amen. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that ye may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. And this is the special verse that I've memorized or tried to. I have to keep rememorizing it. There's the throne of grace that we can all come to. And this is the final atonement that we're talking about. In the process of the atonement. This is what we all need to be doing more than we are.
The question you asked before about how can God do more with a certain group of people than the other,
yes,
is revealed in that verse.
Amen.
Who come,
yes,
and see, but if we refuse to come, he can't give it to us.
That's right.
And come boldly.
Amen.
Amen. These are extremely important verses.
He invites us to come.
Number 22. Hebrews 9:24, for Christ is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. What better place could our intercessor be? Number 23. This is Exodus. Oh, I'm looking at the same, kind of bringing up the point that you were mentioning. You know, God mentioned that he's going to be merciful and gracious. He is merciful and gracious. But at one point, he's going to do that strange act. And that will by no means clear the guilty, etc. And the difference is those who come to the throne of grace. 24.
Second
commandment. That's right. So obviously, because of that, here is an important idea that we find all through the Bible. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. This is Isaiah 55, verse 6. His grace will not be always, you know, available for us if we're not making use of what he's given us.
We won't be able to perceive it. That's seek it when we be able to perceive it.
It will be withdrawn from us. Next one, 25. And this is the 10 virgins in Matthew 25. I have verses 10 and to 13. And we know that there are five wise and five foolish, and five have the blood, have the oil, and five do not. And then the call is made, come out to meet him, and five of them find out, I don't have oil. That's not, obviously, it's not the time to not have oil. And they asked the other five, and they said, you know, if we give you some, we won't have sufficient for ourselves. And reading here, and while they went out to buy, so they told them, why don't you buy some oil? So they went out to buy, the bridegroom came, and they were ready, they that were ready, went in with him to their marriage, and the door was shut. Afterwards came also the other virgin, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. So they were doing the same thing that we can do now, except that grace has been withdrawn. But he answered and said, Verily I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Lord of man cometh. We need to really consider this. Number 26. Here's another saying that, you know, when you're young, you tend to read a verse here and read there, and you don't read before and afterward, after it. And you don't get the full, at least I didn't, get the full understanding of these things. This is Luke 13, verses 23 to 25. Then said one of unto him, I think this was a disciple, but I'm not sure, Lord, are there few that be saved? And he said unto them, Strive to enter in at the strait gate, for many, I say unto you, will seek to enter in and shall not be able. When once the master of the house is risen up, you know, when Michael stands, and hath shut to the door, and ye begin to stand without, and to knock at the door, saying, Lord, Lord, open unto us. And he shall answer and say unto you, same thing that the five virgins heard, I know you not whence ye are. Go to the next one. Okay, here are the, that, remember that manuscript 1, 1915, these are the two letters, or two sources. Manuscript 1, no, February, two letters. One is February 24, 1915, and April 3, 1915. These are written by Willie White. And he wrote down the sayings that Mrs. White mentioned when she was in her bed or whatever, when she was suffering the last time. This is a section which is not found in the recent release. A friend of mine in England, he asked, and he says, you know, I really like this quote, but and I like to understand, you know, get, you know, more of where it came from. And so he gave him both of these letters. This is part of the this is part of what Mrs. White said, that which is not mentioned, but it relates to what we're talking about today. The trouble with us is the tendency to leave things at loose ends. Mrs. White was spending some time thinking about the church. She was thinking about the youth and how, oh, we need to be watchful. And she was just, what can we do about the church? She knew so much of what the church was to experience. And she was worried, I believe. And this one part, the trouble with us is the tendency to leave things at loose ends. We need to get together and fix our minds upon a definite point. We know what we need to do in order to be saved. We're talking about the final atonement. Are we making use of the final atonement? Are we working together for victory? Continuing, we must lift the standard higher and still higher, and all unitedly labor for advance.
3 months before she died.
Yes. Yeah. But that's our problem. We leave things at loose ends. We know what we need to be doing, but are we doing this? Are we thinking, well, I'll get to it?
Lay back, Laodicea.
Yeah. Time. Well, let's go to the next slide. This is Hebrews 8, 1-5. Everybody's looking at this, where he's looking at the sum of the matters. He's trying to put everything together. And now of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such a high priest and high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary of the true sanctuary, which the Lord pitched and not man. I wanted to look especially at verse 3 here. For every high priest is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifices. Wherefore, it is of necessity that this man, I think I added the word Christ, I don't think that's in the verse, should have had brackets, have somewhat also to offer. For if he were on earth, he should not be a priest. Why couldn't Jesus be a priest on earth? There was already a priesthood, and he was not a Levite. That's right. Seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law, who serve unto the example and shadow of the heavenly things. So obviously, Jesus is doing the actual work, atonement. What happened before on earth was only a shadow of things to come. Well, anyway, verse 3, it was wherefore it is of necessity that this man, we know it's talking about Christ, has somewhat also to offer. Jesus had to offer himself. And he had to do it before he could do what he's doing now. What is he doing now? We have, verse 1, we have such a high priest, such an high priest, who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. So he is our intercessor. And the only way he could do that is he had to be prepared. He had to come down and give of himself and to die on the cross.
His blood.
His blood. Hebrews 7:26-27. For such an high priest became us. He became one of us. Who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. So he was righteous. He died a righteous death, right? He never sinned. Continuing verse 27. Who needeth not daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins, and then for the people's. For this he did once, when he offered up himself.
Right.
And so many times, you know, I don't remember if that pastor at camp mentioned this, but you know, so many times they want to say, well, Jesus came up to the most holy place, and you know, once he came up, when he died, and he presented, you know, his blood, and everything was done at that point.
No.
I think that's what they say. But is that what this is really saying? It's not. See, the priests on earth, they had to offer up sacrifices first for their own sins. They were sinning, but Jesus never sinned. So he didn't have to keep offering himself over and over again. And then for the people, he did his sacrifice once because it was a righteous death, and through his blood, he was able to begin the atonement process. Let's go to the next slide. 30. Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him.
That's right.
Now how is he able to save us to the uttermost?
Because he ever lived to make intercession.
Because, reading on, he is able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him. This reminds me of what maybe you said before, or somebody said, you know, many don't come to the throne of grace. Seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. So obviously this is a process. This isn't a one-time deal and everything's done at or near the cross. But it's still going on now. And when it says, wherefore he is able, that's present tense, isn't it? It's not past tense. He is able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. So he lives right now that he can save us. Amen. Okay, the next slide. This is Hebrews 7, verses 23 to 25. And they truly were many priests, because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. But this man, because he continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood. Wherefore, he is able also to save them to the uttermost. And we're obviously reading more than what the 25th verse here is what we read before. He is able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. Amen. So it's because in 24, it's because he continues forever. He's not going to die. That these statements are made, and it's not that Jesus comes once and that's done, just after he rises from the dead, which is preached by, it seems like, most everyone. We must never forget that our doctrines don't really come from Mrs. White. Mrs. White showed us what was in the Bible. Amen. That's important. She does give us a lot of additional information. But she has shown us what was already in the Bible. And, you know, I have a web page. And time and time again, I discovered that myself. You know, I knew that Michael the Archangel was Jesus. And we've always used Mrs. White. And that's what she says, and so that's who he is. But I started to do my own research, and point after point after point I've found. And there's been Adventists come and they say, I've never seen anything like this. And that is a sorry state, that we as Adventists don't know what is taught in the Bible. And we need to study, especially the atonement process, but the other doctrines that we have as well. Let's pray. Kind Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your love, your kindness, and the warnings you've given us. Oh, Jesus is just willing and waiting and spurring us on to come to the throne of grace. There's so much that we're learning here at this camp meeting, but Father, if we leave things at loose ends, if we don't do that ourselves, but wait for some future time, Father, we're going to be lost. We must come to the throne of grace, and we must make use of his grace and his love for us. Amen. And to strive with him, with his righteous arm, and that righteousness can help us, his righteousness, to help us to get rid of our sins, Father, to be strongly in line with him, and also to reach out to others, because this world needs to be saved. Thank you so much, Father. In the name of Jesus, we ask this. Amen.
Amen. Amen.